Sunday morning, 7 o'clock. Whilst the rest of the world sleeps, another day's work begins at Buckfastleigh. It could be any morning in the last 100 years, years when coal and steam reign supreme. But the time is now. What was it about those train journeys of yesteryear that makes so many of us want to relive them? Was it that the engines were more majestic, or the hiss of steam more romantic than the throb of diesel? Or was it just that we were younger then? For as many people as there are probably as many reasons. And today, all the memories are revived on small stretches of branch lines run by societies and their steam enthusiasts throughout the land. At Buckfastleigh, the Dart Valley Light Railway has been operating to Totnes for the last 10 years, and unlike many of its counterparts, very much as a commercial operation. With only a small permanent staff of 21, the members of the Dart Valley Railway Association help out the company by providing volunteers who are willing to do any task that gives them the chance to work with trains, despite the fact that only a few will get the chance to be a driver or a guard. But it's not only the special volunteers who are beguiled by the romance of steam. It's a cult that knows no boundaries, and a new shop and cafe complex caters for the growing tourist demand for trains and tea, history and nostalgia, and books and beef burgers. Three hours after lighting up, engine 1638, a British Rail 060 pannier tank built in 1951, moves off from the sidings to head the first train of the day. In charge is Dave Noling, one of the Dart Valley's longest-serving drivers. Although it now runs independently, the Dart Valley Railway still has to conform to the rules of the road as they apply to British Rail. All are trained to the same exacting standards. When the changeover to diesel took place in the 50s, no one imagined that the demand to perpetuate the era of steam would be so strong. Today, the Dart Valley often runs through trains in conjunction with British Rail. But how helpful are they to the problems facing Barry Cogar?
Very helpful indeed. Without their help, advice, and the hire of equipment at times, you know, we would be in a state. We'd have to buy our own stuff. They've been very, very helpful, and nothing is too much trouble in all departments. Now, all these engines are quite old. How long do you think that you can keep them working and therefore be successful as a company?
Well, the business increases as it is at the moment. We get more money in to maintain them to tip-top standard, and if we look after them and get them to this standard, we should go on the end of my lifetime and pass that.
In the middle of the 19th century, when the rail routes to Plymouth were being discussed, one plan was to take a branch line to Ashburton from Newton Abbot. But after 25 years of talking, the line was eventually built along the delightful valley of the Dart. It was opened on the 1st of May, 1877. British Rail's axe finally fell on passenger traffic in 1958, and ironically, a decade later, it was the man who wielded the blow, Lord Beeching, who was invited to reopen the line for the Dart Valley Railway. Now, and with another line operating commercially between Paignton and Kingswear for Dartmouth, the company has become an established and picturesque part of the holiday scene in South Devon. Last year, more than 120,000 passengers paid to travel the trip to Totnes and back, and more than twice that number on the other line. It was never anywhere near as busy in its heyday, when the fares were counted in halfpennies, and when no less a person than Mr. Gladstone himself decreed that there should be at least one train a day and the fares kept low, one and twopence to Totnes and back. As departure time approaches, the platform seems to step back in time. Part once more of a busy country station, which not so long ago seemed to have gone forever. The volunteers who come to help out arrive from all parts of the country and include solicitors, doctors, bus drivers, sales managers, and school teachers. It's a hobby you can take up at any age, like Stan Fuller.
Well, I retired when I was 72. I used to be an office manager when I was 65. And then when I left, I was on retirement. One of the fellows that worked down here came and asked me if I'd like a job. I said, what sort of job? He said, be guard on the train. Well, I said, I know nothing about guard duties. At any rate, I got through the exam and passed the medical and all that sort of stuff. And I started in 1972. This is about the eighth season now. I found it very interesting and met a lot of good friends here. Years ago when I commenced on this line as a boy, you know, going to school at Totnes. And in those days, the train ran from Ashburton to Totnes, a distance of 10 miles. And of course, the carriages in those days were quite different to what the open carriages are now. There were just two carriages on the line, and they were five aside, no toilets nor anything like that. And as a boy, of course, there was a certain rivalry between the Ashburton boys and the Totnes boys, but didn't get into much trouble at all. But in those days, of course, you got milk going to Totnes to the milk factory and rabbits, stacks of rabbits on the platform going up to Birmingham. And then years ago, Buckfastleigh used to have races here, National Hunt races. And all the horses used to come by rail then, instead of by motor transport as they are now. But the line itself was quite a busy one because at Buckfastleigh there are industries, woolen mills, and at Buckfast, there's another woolen mill there, and there were the paper mills. And this was one of the busiest lines for goods traffic in the southwest. But of course, when road transport came into being, that all died out and it was closed down in 58 for passengers.
Halfway to Totnes, and the train draws into Staverton. And Staverton, strategically placed milk churns and all, even in the 70s, still belongs to an age when roses and neatly tended flower beds were the local porter's joy, and when stories like the railway children sprang from the pens of writers who were entranced by that very special atmosphere that can only be found in this sleepy country station. Who nurtures this nostalgia is Bob Saunders.
Well, it's 21 years ago now that the first seeds were sown, and basically it arose out of one's concern that the heritage of the old Great Western Railway was fast being lost and that something should be done to preserve that era of steam. And in consequence, a friend of myself set about investigating the possibility of starting a standard gauge railway to preserve some of these particular items of rolling stock and the railway scene as a whole. But after this passenger service closed in 1958, it wasn't until 1962 that the freight service finally was withdrawn, and then commenced 7 years of hard struggle to complete the negotiations to acquire the line. It appeared that we would want something like £70,000, and that the best way in which to achieve this was to set up an association of volunteers and other interested parties. And this is what we actually did. In the next 5 years, until 1968, we started to restore the line with the blessing of British Rail, and being Great Western, of course, course, it was usually maintained with a fairly high standard, and the struggle to do so wasn't too great. And no doubt those who travel in it do feel that we have attempted to preserve something of the whole era of the Great Western Railway, and particularly the period of steam.
Four times a year, usually on bank holidays, steam galas are held at Buckfastleigh, and shining, puffing traction engines make of the place a carnival. It's not only the steam engines which attract. The gala days put a whole working railway on show. Not only its regular services, but the unending maintenance that's needed to keep those services running. One of the line's proudest possessions is a 70-year-old steam crane, which has never yet had a major overhaul. It weighs 108 tons and is capable of lifting 36 tons. The crane is used on both lines for a variety of jobs, including track maintenance as well as routine work on boilers and coaches, a rare and splendid sight of the power of coal and steam. Everywhere, everybody seems to be busy or involved. People united in an enthusiasm for an age when men and machines work together in a combination of majesty and skill, far removed from a minuscule silicon chip. From April to October, the permanent staff are continually stretched with the day-to-day running of the company. But even when the last tourist leaves, none is short of work. There are 9 running locomotives to overhaul, and during the winter months, the staff deploy their skills in the workshops, cleaning, painting, and welding. When the Dart Valley Railway first started, some of the engines were restored in the old Great Western workshops at Swindon. But costs make that impossible today, so the workforce has to be prepared to tackle anything, from boilers to pistons. Strict safety standards are laid down by the Department of Transport, and all the boilers have to be checked regularly by their inspectors. With a pressure of 200 pounds per square inch, the smallest defect could bring disaster. It's in the winter, above all other times, that the volunteers show their dedication, stripping and greasing and tackling jobs far removed from the glamour of the guard's green flag. Many of the volunteers are British Rail staff, and for them all, it's a true labour of love. faster than fairies, faster than witches, bridges and houses, hedges and ditches, and charging along like troops in a battle, all through the meadows, the houses and cattle, and all of the sights of the hill and the plain, fly as thick as driving rain, and ever again, in the wink of an eye, painted stations whistle by. Despite travelling the 7 miles to Totnes and back several times a day throughout the summer, Dave Noling doesn't find it boring. Each day brings new people and an ever-changing face to a line which runs along one of the loveliest stretches of river in the country. Driver's passport to travel the single line track is also used to change the points when the engine changes ends at Totnes Riverside. Regulations, unfortunately, don't allow the Dart Valley Company to operate onto the main line and into the main station, except when specials are being run. And at the moment, there's no direct access to the town. So the stopover is a brief one, long enough, though, to experience at close quarters the routine hiss and clank as the changeover is effected. With one or two exceptions, most of the locomotives owned by the Dart Valley came from the vast graveyard of steam engines at Barry in South Wales. At one time, more than 200 of them were slowly rusting and deteriorating there as they waited to be cut up for scrap. It was a treasure trove for the enthusiasts, and several societies were formed to buy up some of them and preserve them for future generations. Most of them, like this 80,000, were not fit to travel the permanent way to their new destination, and in the days before the motorway, the winding roads of Devon were not the easiest to negotiate.
Here, the top section is the valves,
yes.
And then the bottom section is your piston that actually does the work. It's got an 18-inch diameter bore and a 28-inch diameter stroke. We've been working on this engine for just over 6 years now. And during that 6 years, we spent somewhere around about £7,000 on parts for it. The original purchase price was £4,000 from the scrapyard, and that was the scrap price at the time. It's not an inflated price.
Had they taken all the copper and brass off it then?
Yes, all the copper and brass fittings and so on had been taken off of it. Yeah, and that's what's cost us some money to replace. We found a great deal of difficulty in finding the patterns and so on to replace them. Unfortunately, British Railways Engineering at Swindon have helped us a great deal. They've allowed us into their pattern stores to find the proper patterns. A great deal of effort, as you can see, has gone into it. We were at one time down to a workforce of about two, and fortunately that's increased now. We have a workforce of about six. once it's completed, then it will be on loan to the Dark Valley Railway Company for their use.
There are four groups restoring engines at Buckfastleigh, and those working on the 50-year-old Dumbleton Hall still have a long way to go.
The society was formed in about 1973 by a group of enthusiasts in the Bristol area, and after an initial inspection of the engines at Barry, it was decided that this engine, 4920 Dumbleton Hall, was in fact the best one of its type still remaining. A price was agreed with the scrap merchant there of £4,400, which is quite cheap compared with the prices nowadays, as they've gone up to about £8,000 or £9,000. The engine is in fact now 50 years old, having come out of Swindon Works in 1929. We estimate that the total cost of restoring the engine to working order will be in the region of £20,000, and so far we've spent about £10,000 on the purchase, the transport and the restoration work carried out so far. Should take us, I should say, another 5 years to get the engine back into traffic again, and the Dark Valley Railway will then use the engine on the Torbay Steam Railway, where it'll be very useful on the steep gradients and be able to cope with the heavy summer traffic.
Valley as a driver when he was made redundant by British Rail, but on one occasion he became a very important passenger.
When the Dark Valley brought it over, I took the first train out of here, and I was on the train that Lord Beeching was on when he officially opened the line, and I had my wedding reception on the train as well.
Travelling a country line sometimes brings its lighter moments.
One day we had some pigs, the farmer was trying to get across the line and no way would they go. And he decided to lay a trail of food from one field across the line to the next field. And we come round the corner and he's right in the middle of the track eating the food. And we had to stop there and wait until they finished eating before they'd move off and we could move off.
In the 11 years he's been with the company, Dave calculates he's travelled 80,000 miles up and down the track to Totnes. For each 14-mile trip, the fire consumes at least 500 weight of coal and more than 500 gallons of water. It's not surprising that by the end of the working day, both engine and footplate crew are covered in grime. And just like the morning preparations, it takes a long time before the engine can be safely left for the night. Delightfully, the sight of a steam train's white smoke puffing in the distance is still with us. But hidden in the memories and the nostalgia are the stark economic facts that steam trains are expensive to run and dirty to work. How many of today's visitors have realized, as they return to their caravans and cottages, that for their driver, there are still hours of work to be done? More than half a driver's day is spent in the preparing and disposing of the engine. With a good fireman behind the shovel, there usually isn't too much fire left in the box. But each day, the embers have to be thrown out, the smoke box cleaned, and last of all, the ash pan cooled and raked out into the pit. until then does the day finally end, to drift silently towards the clanking and the hissing and the bustle of tomorrow's dawn, to the first train of a new day.